ABBA and their string of classic hits are legendary. But it wasn't just all about the music. Through album sleeves, videos and stage costumes, the ABBA image was carefully crafted into an international brand. Their look was central to the success of how we perceived the group. A stylistic positioning to launch the legend that is ABBA. When the four members started working together as Bjorn, Benny, Agnetha and Annifrid, early record sleeves suggest they'd given little thought to their image.
Is it good design? It was good design for its time. By today's standards, probably not.
By the early 70s, the glam rock era was upon us. Artists experimented with their image and the key phrase, anything goes, was applied liberally. The cops are out.
Fashion in the 70s, the early 70s, was the most colourful, kind of over-the-top style. What men were wearing, and men being probably at their most feminine. Everybody was wearing colours.
I did like these outrageous clothes. If you can get the music and the image to sit like that, then you've got something. You've got something huge. There are not many who have reached this, the real heights, who have just had the music or just had the image.
Sweden hosted the Eurovision Song Contest for the first time in 1974. ABBA wanted to make a huge impact with Waterloo. Their extravagant glam look left a significant impression on viewers.
Either you loved that sort or you hated it because it was so extreme.
I mean, I can see why the comparisons were drawn between Sweet and ABBA. It was almost like a continuation.
The designer of the costumes was taking all the big fashion trends of the moment and exaggerating them.
A lot of character, a lot of style, and it didn't look like anything else.
Whatever they did, ABBA, was the right thing for them, because their image and their music sat so beautifully together.
With the beads and the makeup and even the way that they moved, they were completely feminine, totally feminine. I don't think there's a tomboy bone in either of them. The opposite of me, really.
Waterloo catapulted ABBA to international stardom in 1974, and the subsequent album release was the first to consider their image.
The photograph itself is not particularly shot in a particularly glamorous style. The lighting is not particularly glamorous. It's a very grainy shot, like a kind of fine art photograph in a way.
After the Waterloo triumph, ABBA struck up a collaboration with the designer who was to create some of their most memorable outfits.
My ideas concerning stage costumes, they should lift the artist without killing the image.
Sandström formed the Stockholm-based company Artist Dressing in the early 70s. He was always looking for interesting and eye-catching fabrics for the ABBA costumes and bought most of them in London.
And actually, we've got a new shade of gold in the stretch satin.
Uwe's career started when he was a flamenco dancer and designed his own outfit. After a few years, his company was one of the most sought after in Swedish show business.
The colour range is slightly, but they really reflect a lot of light, especially if you've got stage lighting and you would pick up all the colours on the lenses of the projection lights.
Gorgeous.
That would be very
gorgeous.
Very good.
Absolutely.
By taking the current glam rock trend fully on board, Uwe's collaboration with ABBA got off to a glittering start.
We all wanted to create something crazy, something wild. And that's how the whole thing started. And that was a simple communication. yes, go for it, and here we start. Let's see what we can produce together. Bjorn, for example, he looked like Superman, a combination of a Superman or a science fiction action figure. That was something extra. If you look at Agneta, I must say that she looked something like Barbarella. She had short pants, I would say two short pants, hot pants. People said, are you actually serious? And that's actually when Bjorn said, of course it is, nothing
is too wild.
Uwe's next assignment would showcase some of his most famous outfits. Originally created for ABBA's tour of Europe in 1974, the costumes were soon to gain worldwide exposure.
This is Agneta's stretch costume. I really wanted to show the audience how well-trimmed the girls were. So, when the papers were writing about the performance, they were actually writing much more about Agneta's famous bottom, because the material left nothing to your fantasy. I was inspired by the flamenco, the skirts, the colors, perhaps a little bit of carnival. To conceal the top of Agneta, we had a cape with the same bands, ribbons with sequences. But you see, it had a little secret. You could open it up like this. So the sleeve, all of a sudden, became a complete cape. I'm afraid I made something different. 1974, I think it was a little bit too early for see-through materials, but it was a sensation. These sequences are actually made from mother pearl, real mother pearl, cut into thin, thin slices. A miniskirt with ribbons, and all those ribbons are free from each other. So you realize what happens when you turn around. All those ribbons are far apart, and you could see what was happening.
Costume played a big part in creating ABBA's new style. But video also had a key role to play in building the image.
Since they didn't want to tour that much, they hired me and asked me if I wanted to do their clips, so they sent those out for free to all the television stations.
Lassie Hallström had spent a number of years making pop promos and short skits for Swedish television, and it was this work that brought him and ABBA together.
They were very fresh and spontaneous and I think charming in a way. We did comments on daily news, and we, you know, we picked headlines and we made up sketches about it.
The video for Mamma Mia is broadly seen as one of the most iconic of the 70s. Costumes played their part, but so did the visual trademarks of ABBA's director.
I thought the lyrics said the Mamma Mia was very percussional in a way, so I thought maybe I should do a close-up of the lips for that. So I put one in profile, one right here, and then I shifted focus between those lips and those lips. And it was just sort of inspired by the rhythm of the song. It's so great that this became the signature shot. There was a frustrated drummer in me, but instead of drumming, I was cutting, doing the cuts and moving the camera and zooming in, zooming out, shifting focus, cutting on the first beat, doing all these things to support the beat and the music. It's so great that this became the signature shot for ABBA, the face-on profile.
But visual flair and costumes were only part of what was to become the ABBA signature.
You suddenly realise that you have to think through what's the main signal you want to communicate. And then you work it through and you develop all the parts, the logotype, the visual communication, the oral communication, or whatever it is.
One of the leading cover designers in the 70s was a company called Hypnosis, whose elaborate sleeves set an international trend. Storytelling and subliminal messages were the flavor of the day, and ABBA's third album cover was a part of that dialogue.
Like the covers we did at Hypnosis, it's a kind of cover that you stare at for as long as it takes, and you can read so many things into it. Maybe they're off to some strange party or a ball or a banquet or something, I don't know. That picture just says, we're here, it's success, we've made it big, we're ABBA.
The last piece of the image puzzle came via the album photographer. He suggested a friend, a graphic designer with strong opinions.
He told me he worked with albums for ABBA, I think two. And I saw them and said, for Christ's sake, they must have a logo. And they said, let him try, let him come in with an idea. And I did that.
Rune Soderqvist worked in advertising, but his creative roots were embedded in the pop art era of the 60s. Rather than work with 70s ornate and bubbly typeface, he designed a minimalist logo that went against the album trends of the time. Initially, ABBA weren't convinced that this pared-down look was right.
Then he said, is that not a little bit too industrial? And I said that maybe you don't understand that, but I think I will work a hell of a lot with together with you, and I think I know how to use it. And then I said, I think 20 different ways you can use it.
Very surprising that it would be such a plain logo, albeit with that little mirrored twist. That was way before its time.
But logotypes in the 70s was not very fun. One can look like a bird's nest. I had to work very hard to stick to my own manual, so to say, which is to be very clean.
You have the Björn and Benny initials in the middle, back to back, like a very close team working together. It's almost like a kind of double heart. And they are really the heart of ABBA. And then the girls, A's on the side. And it really looks like two girls standing in short skirts.
The ABBA logo was first seen on the single Dancing Queen. That same year, the group's fourth album used the logo as an integrated part of sleeve design, brand conceptualized from start to finish.
My former wife said to me, call it Arrival. And after that, the idea was clear that it's nice to have an helicopter where you can put four people together close in a natural way.
It was intrusive, that helicopter is right in your face and the four of them sitting in the front seat. What are the four of them doing in that helicopter? What's also intriguing is that the top half of the album cover is a very dark black sky. Is this a foretaste of things to come? You know, the beginning of the end, the beginning of the breakup of the personal relationships and the marriages, who knows?
Here you see that every ingredients, the logotype, the design of the sleeve, and the clothes and everything are components that work together very well to create this whole ABBA image.
The focus of ABBA's image was Agneta and Frida. Their individuality couldn't be ignored. So designer Uwe Sandström encouraged their input, and in the mid-70s produced one of the group's most memorable costumes for a TV showcase made in Sweden.
I was talking to Agneta and Frida, and she said, sometimes I feel like a tiger. Great. You think you could have some kind of a tunica or short dress with a tiger on? Yes, that would be something. So I made a suggestion. And then Agneta said, but what am I going to have? I said to Agneta, I have a cat here in the house, in the studio. We can paint him in blue. So the role model for the panther, the blue panther on this costume, is actually my own cat. If you look to the claws, you could see it looks like nails. On the backside, if you turn it around like this, you could see Frida's name. Decorated with stones, even Agneta had her name on the backside. there we are. The inside of the long skirt had the same colors as the Swedish flag, the blue and yellow.
Dresses were just one of several costume looks that managed to trade on sex appeal while still retaining a clean and wholesome image.
The ABBA fashions were very sexy, and I think the 70s was the time actually when girls were getting more confident about themselves and feeling, and now you felt, yes, you could go around looking quite sexy and still be this, you know, strong, liberated woman.
The girls are the ones that are meeting the audience and sort of symbolizing or giving ABBA their visual identity.
Performance underpinned the onstage image, and choreographer Graham Tatton chose to avoid complicated steps, using Agneta and Frida's natural rhythms as his starting point. This produced a style everyone could copy on the dance floor.
I give them the freedom of movement. Like, tell them they're in a discotheque and they should just move. Then I could see what their movements are like and I can work on that instead of giving them movements that doesn't suit their personality.
Graham adapted his work to suit the different styles and personalities of ABBA's lead singers. Agneta was reserved and self-conscious, but Frida was far more outgoing.
She loved dancing. She wanted me to give her more. But I had to stop her sometime because we had Agneta too. She was very shy. But when one peps her up and give her compliments and things, then she really comes up. And I saw that sexy movement in her. And I said, well, let me work on that. Let her be that one. And then Frida will be the dancing one, the dancing queen. First, I listen to the music, listen to the text, and then I let them do their own movements, their own ways. From there, I could detect what I could give them. I have to do things that they can't do, but they try, and that's what gave me inspiration, because they were so willing to try. And sometimes I could just laugh and they get embarrassed. I would just burst out with laughter and they took it the right way.
While ABBA's image remained all important, tight video budgets, courtesy of manager Stig Andersson, presented a constant challenge for the director.
We started shooting in my apartment. You can really see it's nice. You can see how we had furnished our living room. It's a long dolly shot. And that was the way I lived in those days. Me and you, feeling lost and feeling blue, it's the end. I put them in a flower pot with wheels. And the sound guy is lying down outside the frame and turning this flower pot around. So the girls' heads are turning like that. So it was low budget for sure. Happy New Year, Happy New Year. May we all have our hopes, our will to try. If we don't, we might as well. I listen to the songs and I know I only get one day to do them. So I do a shot list. Maximum three locations for each song. I call the guy who rents the cameras. He also becomes the lighting, the gaffer, and does the light, and then I have the sound guy. who does the sound, and he may be pushing the dolly that I have too. So we're a crew of three people. I edit myself an editing table I have at home, and that's really it, yeah. I remember standing in my country house calling Stig Andersson to ask for a raise. And I was not the best negotiator, so I said, you think I could maybe get a little more? Hello, hi, you can't! So he started screaming and yelling, and not screaming and yelling, but he said it was really tough. There was no way I could get a raise. Knowing me, knowing you, there is nothing we can do. Knowing me, knowing you. You can still see the clip of Knowing Me, Knowing You, where you can see the backdrop being wrinkled, and I'm still embarrassed when I watch it. You can see it's just a piece of cloth that I was hanging.
By 1977, ABBA were established as one of the biggest pop music acts on the planet and were ready to embark on their first major tour, taking in Europe and Australia.
We made huge efforts to make it really perfect. Frida is actually taking a great part in discussing costume, what to wear, how to wear it, and when to use it. Shorts, and they were shorts, extremely short they were. And on top, a small bolero. Opening up the bolero, she had a sequenced, a golden sequenced stretch top like this. But Frida sometimes wanted to change. So that's the reason why I also designed this long pair of pants, pirate inspired, I should say. They were open with slits, and a golden decoration for Agneta.